because he's nearby.
Maybe we should.
Yes, and the lady.
Thank also. You.
Because it's a. Same problem at 7:30 in the morning. Only the panels was there, and then there was a very nice discussion about it. It was nice, it was funny, but it was suspected that it could be happen the same, because this time the streets are not built, and then the people normally decide to stay on the bed.
Yes.
And we enjoyed a lot. And we was preparing this together, and we have enjoyed it a lot of fun, laughing a lot. Yeah, of course. You like it too.
Yeah,
it would be like a family. Yes. 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 Yeah. Yeah. For the camera focus, would be better to have a small group that's not so empty. Okay, our friend. Okay, let's start.
Yes, we can start.
Okay, perfect. Okay, good morning to everyone. Thank you for being here this very early in the morning session. And we are here to in this panel to discuss about recovering time, education, and productivity lost recovery. And then I am here as a chair of this session. My name is José Ramón Calvo. I am from Spain, from the Royal European Academy of Doctors. And also I am the advisor of the Barcelona Supercomputing Center. I'm a physician by background, and I'm very happy to have here with this distinguished panel of guests and our friends. Each one of them will introduce themselves. And I would like to start with a brief introduction about what does mean the COVID pandemic. And I think that the COVID pandemic has a significant impact on the world, causing widespread illness, death, and economic disruption. One of the most significant effects of the pandemic has been the loss of time, education, and productivity. Many people have lost their jobs, and students have missed out on valuable classroom times. Recovering from these losses will be a significant challenge, requiring innovative solutions and collaboration across sectors. To address these challenges, many discussions have been held around the world to bring together experts from various fields to discuss strategies for recovery. These discussions have focused on a range of topics, from health equity to economic empowerment to reskilling young people from green jobs. And today, in this roundtable, we will explore some of the insights that have emerged from these international discussions applied to the reality of each one of our countries. Then, I think that it's my turn to give the floor to each one of our of my colleagues here to present themselves, and then we can start the discussion. And then, Anna?
Mm-hmm.
Yes.
That didn't work.
Yes, no.
My name is Hanna Ace. I'm a Norwegian technology entrepreneur. I started my first company when I was 25. But before that, I started a social media consultancy company. So I was one of the very early people believing in social media as a technology. Back when people were pretty much very much against it. So that's how I started. And now I've been in entrepreneurship, innovation, and technology, and social impact, because that's the reason I'm in it, for almost 20 years now. And I had a little bit of a shift the last years, seen that us as technology entrepreneurs are creating products. Why are we creating products if the people behind the products might be not okay? What can we more do for them as humans instead of just creating technology for them? And this is where I am passionate about the education system that needs to change, because as for now, I believe we are learning things in school that are maybe not the most important things for us as humans when we enter the world of the workforce. So that's my passion area lately. But technology is my angle into this panel today.
Thank you very much. And then, Denise? Yes, okay.
I am Liz Şener Kalilioğlu from Istanbul, Turkey. I'm so glad that Horace has brought us together. And our subject is so important, especially post-COVID. We don't need to look backwards, but we need to look forward. And I'm a psychologist, but doing my PhD right now in the University of US. And it's mainly online. Before pandemic I started, and it was online at that time already, but it had residencies. So we needed to go to residencies, face-to-face with the instructors, some of our courses, and some parts of the program. However, pandemic and COVID resulted that they also made them into online, which affected me directly in the education. Other than that, I have my training and coaching company. I'm training people since many years. I trained in more than 36 countries, traveled 19 countries. And at those times, when we were needing to go in all those countries and to train, to give training, it was a hassle for many participants to come from their countries. 100 nationalities attend my trainings. But it was always time consuming, and also related so much with the budgets. But now, after COVID, it's more reasonable that we do the trainings online. People get used to that with the productivity of that, with the savings of that. So this subject is in my heart. I'm into education. My passion is education, in schools and in workplaces, in the education for every age, especially in the companies, where the companies are making their HR programs to develop their talent, and especially the leadership development. So, thank you very much.
Thank you very much. Ado?
Yes, so, my name is Beniza Ado from Ghana, West Africa. So what we do, we are a tourism company that we help promote tourism in Ghana, and as well as invite investors who want to invest in Ghana. So post-COVID, we have to go to some sites where we do some of our tour packages outside the city. And having gone to those places, we realized that private areas had issues when it had come with learning online, because most of these places schools had difficulties with studies, with remote learning, access to technology and everything. So that is where our passion started to develop for education and e-learning, and that's where we took our passion to start doing something.
Okay, thank you. Dr. Shaki?
Good morning.
Yes.
Good morning. My name is Akinori Seki from Tokyo. I work for Tokyo Keizai University in Tokyo. Keizai means economics in English. Actually, I've been involved in education for nearly 30 years. I started my career at a government non-school high school teacher. And then I got a job at a university. And interestingly, I became a dean and a co-member of my university in April of 2020, when the COVID pandemic. And then, because I was the youngest dean, I was Paul to be in charge of making strategy. 19, and you know, the education itself, we can turn into online. But every week we have a small meeting with our students. So thanks to that situation, I got the first-hand information about the Japanese government strategies. And also, I'm the president of organization which promote the international exchange in Asian region. So due to COVID, that activity was involved. And today I would like to talk about this, and I get afterward to get advice from you.
Thank you. Well, I will start with you making you some question. Sorry, Phil. My what? It was in my list, it was the second. Yes, now.
Hello, everyone. I'm Phil Mullen, and I'm an inclusive music educator. And what that means is two things, really. One is that I make sure or work towards everybody in the world, any age, any ability, any background, being able to participate in music making and creating music. That's a big part of what I do. But the other part of what I do is tackling exclusion, tackling the ideas of being, I see inclusion to a large extent as the opposite of exclusion. So tackling exclusion. So I work a lot with groups that have been excluded, such as those with mental health issues, disabled people, people with very poor socioeconomic backgrounds, and so on and so forth. So my COVID experience has been from, you know, right all the way through as an educator, but it's still relevant pretty much every week, if not every day, because I mentor teachers who still say continuously that their classes are disrupted because of mental health issues, and that's what I know we're going to be talking about. Mental health issues, mostly among the students, also sometimes amongst the teachers as well. Thank you.
Thank you very much, Ms. Holly. Yes, thank you. The question is that while the rest of the world was on lockdown and severely restricted people activities during the COVID pandemic, people in Japan were able to do almost a normal life. How can you explain the situation there? And also, I would like to ask every one of you, how did you feel in that particular time in your places? Because I think that the example of Japan is good to start this discussion.
As I have already told you, I'm involved in actively an international exchange project within Asian regions. And in 2020, in February and March, we conducted an exchange program in Nepal, Asia, and with in another countries two times. And then we, thanks to the event, we got again the first hand information about the COVID. In 2020 March, I was in Bangkok. The Bangkok airport is so crowded usually, but at that time the Bangkok airport was so empty, so I felt something wrong. And again in Singapore, I was at the Singapore airport. After the day, the Singapore closed the border. And everybody was in confusion, and some people started screaming because the foreign student wanted to go into the Singapore, but at the 0 o'clock, they closed the border. Yeah, but that experience, I never forget that. Okay, I went back to Japan, and I, as I told you, I started to be in charge of making strategies. Okay, and then at that time, I had a regular contact with people from Asian countries, in most countries, and they, the lockdown, stay home policy was enacted, but in Japan, Japanese government didn't do that. But actually, in other countries, the student had to stay in home, not only students, but old people stay home, but in Japan, we were allowed to go out. We are, the school was changed to online, So a student didn't stop coming to university, but what they did is they went back to their hometown, and then they started working actively in the hometown. And they did part-time job, and they started playing with kids. Actually, I said that they went back to their comfort zone. And this is a big difference between in Japan and I think most of the countries. Mm-hmm. Yeah, that caused the difference. Then I will talk about it later.
Mm-hmm. Okay. Any comment about what the Dr. Seki talked?
So, were the nightclubs open? Were the restaurants open?
Okay. The restaurant were closed at 8 o'clock, but until 8 o'clock they could enjoy. And then the convenience stores opened. And then what happened is the younger generation and bought a lot of stuff and enjoyed home party.
And there was no rules for how many
And the strong Japanese government strongly recommended keeping social distance.
But was not mandatory.
No.
And during the pandemic, how was the sensation that you feel in your respective countries, for example?
Yes, I mean in Ghana during the pandemic, when they locked down, a lot of policies and government have lots of hardware problems. Mandatory timings, for example, for students, which everybody has to, the schools had to shut down, clubs had to shut down, and hospitals were open. Where some offices closed, some were working at the house or on the home. But as time began to, we started making some progress with the nose masks and everything. Some institutions started allowing students in with the policy of social distancing. Some companies started asking staff to come into work. A number of staff, especially those who had vital works to do, others were asked to stay home. So the policies that the government initiated brought a bit of relief to the citizens. There were other times that things became very difficult because nobody had access to a lot of things, especially they had to go to pharmacies had to go to certain times. Problem with access to goods and everything, medical issues for vehicles in the private areas had to go to the hospital. But since then, they shut how do somebody is pregnant and about to give birth, have access to medical facilities. So we had lots of issues, but during, as time went on, things became better. And then it was rough, but it was okay.
Talk about it on different levels. So on the government level, the government put money available so that people could stay in jobs and all that. At that level, at that time, that was good. We went in and out of lockdown a number of times. So we were in lockdown, then we weren't in lockdown, then we were back in lockdown, then we were back in. But one of the things that happened, our national health system is very important in England, where I live. It's a free health system, the country really got behind the nurses and the doctors, but then the politicians did not obey the rules, so there became some scandals, that the politicians did not observe lockdown. So this damaged the relationship in the country between the politicians and the people that was damaged already. So that's on one level. On the level of work and education, we, as a music education, and so in music, you play with your student in real time. We're here in the room together, we play together. When you move to online, there's a delay, a sound delay, which makes it extremely difficult to do. And I have to say, the whole music education profession in England, not just inclusive, but across all of England, did very well to adapt to lockdown. Now, it's not good enough. It's not, for our topic, it's not good enough. You need to be in the room if possible. But people did relearn new skills very, very well on a personal level. And I think it's kind of important because it changes the, what we're talking about slightly. Given my own health and age, I really had to stay in because I was vulnerable. But I'm the youngest of my family. So I had siblings across the world who, this is difficult to say, as one as I, but also they hadn't left the house, and some have still not left their house because they're afraid of. It's a psychological fear more than a physical fear. COVID has waned; it's still there, but it's more than that. But because they are very vulnerable to COVID, they still have not left their own home. They still get everything delivered. So it's not something we know about that these longer. There is a small part of the population, but they're significant, who still are in COVID times. Right? Thank you.
Thank you.
Was at risk of dying. She had a high age. for me. When I went into lockdown with her, because the healthcare workers for the elderly in Norway, they don't require education. So anyone basically in Norway can work with the elders. And we really saw, at least I did from a next of kin perspective, that the knowledge also lacked in how to prevent the virus, because they didn't have education. So it was really challenging times where I feel that the government failed the elders, but they did a good job otherwise. School-wise, Norway has one of the best Wi-Fi broadbands in the world. Our young people have grown up with technology. They're probably one of the most advanced technology young people in the world. I think the teachers were struggling more, which I'm sure we're going to talk more about. And childcare was open only for the workers who had children that they had to go to work, which were, of course, the hospitals and police and so on. But apart from that, the young people were the ones that were struggling to keep up with these rules. Mm-hmm. So you saw a real difference between grown-ups and people in their 20s. They were partying like there was no tomorrow. Mm-hmm. So there was it was a really challenging time, but in my depending on if you had somebody you cared about.
Yes, yes.
Or not. The difference there was massive, and it's still to this day it's kind of hard to forgive the people that didn't care if you had one that was at risk of dying of it. So, yeah.
Definitely, I think that the elder people suffer most than any other part of the population in other countries. Probably in all your countries are the same, because I think that one of the lessons that we take from the pandemic was that we need to take care more with the older, because they are more vulnerable than others.
Yes, I was glad to what you were saying. Yes, so during the lockdown, our government bought several courses, as we say. Churches were open for those 2 hours, some basic things that I had to do. And there was no mask campaign. But it was time for campaign. They had to campaign for power. And I know what happened. They have brought those policies ignored. Because during that time, we're doing good with the cases. The cases were calming down a bit. And then the campaign started. They ignored all the rules, and we could, at a campaign, we could have about 15 to 20,000 people. Yeah? And there was a lot of spikes in the cases. But so many cases of death, in some of the politicians, in some of the people. So I think some of the politicians also didn't help during the number of times. Yeah.
I just want to add, I think that's why, like, we cannot depend on our leaders, then who can we depend on, right? And I think that's also coming back to education. It's one of the reasons why it's so important that we need well-educated leaders that understand the complexity of things. So yes, I just wanted to add that.
Well, what do you think about that?
I totally agree. And people need to walk the talk. And if they are some rules, the rules should be for everyone. We had some issues, and in general, it worked fine. Also, we should think psychologically, it's really hard for everyone. And the youngsters, yes, they were not thinking the future, but we should also think about people, how their psychology in that age, how their psychology in the elders' age, and the one who is still not going out. My mother didn't want to leave home for so many months, even after the main COVID time passed. Mm-hmm. And people have that fear or the feeling of it, and maybe they get so much used to staying at home.
Yeah.
So we should start when we are
speaking well.
In
microphone, please.
Yes.
In many Asian countries, not only in Japan, there is a tendency that people accept power distance.
Mm-hmm.
And my wife is German, and she's different from Japanese. And she always said that Japanese people should use your brain. You shouldn't be so obedient. But actually, you know, Japanese people are very obedient to the authorities. So authorities and direction or university direction is crucial because the students obey. They don't ignore the regulations. Yeah.
So what is power distance? That was
power distance is that, you know, for example, the student respect me because I'm a professor.
Mm.
Even though my lecture is boring, they respect me. This is the tendency in Asia and in some South American countries.
So just, and I'm from the United States, and we have a collection of Norway's and Sweden all over the place. And it seems to me that the response to COVID was overshadowed, rather than being a health concern, it turned into a political concern, where everybody followed their favorite politician without a cohesive responsiveness. I don't think it's a lack of education. I think that some of these people decided politics is more important. And I just kind of wonder what happened past that, or what happens when the next pandemic happens, how we can sort of not be facing this situation that was, for us, believed was a once in a while, was a first time in the years, but I don't think it's going to be the last.
On what Seki-san said, like every shows us the importance of cultural awareness,
mm-hmm.
and also there is an important psychologist called Hofstede, and it was the dimensions that he brought up, and power distance is one of that, and there also another one is avoidance of uncertainty. So these kind of dimensions define a lot of reactions of the people. So if you want to understand our people, we can look at these kind of dimensions in how they react. So we would expect that the Japanese or Chinese would obey the rules, while we might not expect it.
Latin American or Mediterranean areas that probably we are not so obedient as the Japanese or Asian people. Okay, I have because we are talking about mental health and this kind of, I think that is interesting to know and to discuss a little bit about the mental health issues of students, of educators and parents during the pandemic and the importance of the emotional support, and both of you have talked about that. I think that it could be a good point for discussion about that. Phil?
Sure, that's definitely my area. We have, just to kind of get the context of why that might be an issue for kids, yeah? We have the idea that, I was thinking about this before, you know, and really COVID, we've been working towards globalization, yeah? In many different ways, since I remember it, but I'm much older than many here. The Beatles in 1967 broadcast to 500 million people, "All You Need Is Love," and that was the start. That was the start of the whole globalization thing for me. And now we finally arrived at globalization because we knew we were all, every single one of us, was united together by COVID. Yeah? Not a good thing, not a good way to experience globalization and the shock and the terror of that. Because, you know, people of my age, we would know that the world, even though it has weeks like the last couple of weeks we've had, very terrible weeks in world affairs, we would know that there will be different days ahead. At least so far, things can change and improve. Kids don't know that. Kids, the impact of COVID on kids is, this is what the world is. This is how they experience the world. We're locked in a room and we can't, We can't touch people, we can't be close to them, we can't, yeah? We have to be distant from them, we have to wear a mask. Extraordinary way to go into China. So the impact of that's been extraordinary. So World Health Organization said that after the first year of COVID, there was a 25% global rise in depression and anxiety. So it's a, you know, a huge, massive thing. Now some things are fixing themselves, yeah. But with the student population, we've gone in England from, we used to have, and it's far too high, it was far too high. We used to have one in nine students, so three students in a mainstream school would have a diagnosable mental health problem. Now, you know, some of those would be acting in, we call it, which means they internalize their issues. Some act out, which means they pose behavior challenges, quite understandably. But if you've got one kid in classroom putting behavior challenges out there, it's probably can cope with it. We now have, from 6 to 16 year olds, we now have one in six with a diagnosable mental health problem. So that means that five kids in every mainstream classroom have a diagnosed mental health problem. It's a pretty big group. Three of those acting out, your class is done. And that's what I'm dealing with. I'm dealing with teachers who go, I have three kids in my class, you know, I've got five kids with mental health problems. Three of them are acting up, they're shouting, screaming, running around the room, throwing things all the time. So that's one, that's the main thing I'd say about it. That's a big mental health issue. The other thing that's happened is that kids just can't cope with going to school. So we've had a figure, now the figure's been contested, I've checked it out. But we have a figure of 140,000 kids in England, now it might be 120,000, who have less than 50% attendance. Some people are calling them the ghost children, it's too dramatic. But, you know, if you've got less than 50% attendance at a school and you're not getting the home support, then your education's gone. You know, it is, I'm sorry, but it is, yeah. So we have real serious problems, and we haven't fully globally come to terms with this. Now, there was a survey, I can't remember who did the survey, but it will come back to me, but survey of 48 countries post-COVID. 10 of them, lots of them have put in supports in community areas, whatever. 10 have put in supports in schools. But only two that, as far as I can see from what I've read, only two of that 48 have looked at training teachers to be more responsive to and more aware of the mental health issues that their students bring. So I think there's a real gap for us as a world. We've got a generation growing up with serious diagnosable mental health problems. We have classrooms are still disrupted in England, I'm gonna have it every week. And we haven't put that extra support in place for the teachers. Now that's my angle as a therapist. Thank you.
There's like two perspectives to it, in my opinion, because I believe children are very adaptable and they will look to their parents to see how are mom and dad dealing with this. And I think, it was really interesting to see that for the children that had suffered loneliness before COVID were in some ways now even better, because they felt now everyone's alone, it's not only me. And I remember having a little bit of the same feeling because I was going through a hard financial time as an entrepreneur at the time, like a really hard one, battling bankruptcy. And at a time where it was hard for me to go out clubbing, spending money on eating out, you know, drinks. And when COVID came, nobody could go out and eat and have drinks. So, you know, for some people, it was a good thing. But for others, of course, and I think especially for the children that had homes where with containing some sort of violence in them at home, that had parents that, you know, had issues, they would be extra affected by being locked up with parents that were not okay, and they didn't get a break from it. So, and then of course parents in the risk zone of mental health were even not okay about that. So that I think was one of the main challenges, and you know, there was so much talk about like the suicide rates would go up, but they didn't. At least there hasn't been any talk about it. And with the mental health situation in Norway with the young people, we have a really interesting one now because it's become trendy to have a diagnosis for the young people, especially because of TikTok. There's a TikTok in Norway, it's basically it's the way the young people get news, the knowledge, education almost, and everything, tips on dating and like from all aspects of life. And TikTok has a lot of videos now, oh, maybe you have this, maybe you're suffering from this. So the psychologists in Norway are being called down by young people because they want to get a diagnosis because they've seen it on TikTok. Oh, wow. And because then they can also talk about, oh, what do you have? I'm hyperactive. Oh, I have anxiety. Oh, really? Like, so it's become a way of like belonging almost. So the numbers are going up, but the question is, of course, why are they going up? Are they going up because more people want, like, they're, yeah. So we have a challenge on our hands, but this is one of the reasons why I believe we need psychology into education itself, because it's crucial. It's the most important thing in life, and maybe if we learn more about it from a young age, we're more prepared for external things in life.
It's a fantastic point. I really like it. Yes.
I want to add on Hannah, on the positive side of COVID, being long time at home. When the COVID started, I had a 5-month-old baby. And normally, we would start going back to business, we would start going back to social life, and if I wouldn't be able to go out because of the baby, I would feel like, oh, all the others are doing this and that, and then have these meetings and that conferences and that's going on, and now I cannot, and so on. But instead, I was heavily with my baby, and even better than that, of course, as a mother, you would be with your baby, or, but better than that, the daddy was at home. It was the luck of the baby to grow up in her first years with the daddy at home 24 hours. So in some case, if you look at from a different angle, you know, it might have brought something extra. Also, I believe it made many of us to sit still and think what we're doing with our lives, what we are thinking about the world, what's the environment. Now, some it kind of disrupted the rush of our busy lives. So it gave us the possibility and the opportunity to be able to digest the life so far and look to our future with more thoughts in our mind. I was going to say something else.
Benazir, what do you think about?
I just want to pick some few challenges we faced. So during the lockdown, even in certain parts of the country, including some deprived areas, students had to go to school to escape certain lifestyle. For instance, if you don't go to school, it means you have to go to the farm. Or you'll be faced to go into early marriage. So there was an opportunity for them to go to school. So you wake up in the morning, you are not going to be rushed to go to the farm, or your mom will not hold your hand to go and give to somebody as you are going to be married. So everybody was going to school. But when the lockdown came, they were home. They were not doing anything. So parents had to wake up in the morning and go to the farm. When issues got harder and parents didn't have money, they exchanged their children into early marriage. Yes. And after the COVID was over, and certain students that were not able to, that were sitting at home, that went to early marriage or certain
so different perspectives from different parts of the world, and each one of us has suffered or had advantages that didn't present in her case, because it was a real advantage. But for the others, it was a real threat. And in Japan, what was the situation?
Okay, as you mentioned, avoidance of uncertainty. Japanese people assent to be very bad at uncertainty situation. And they are waiting for clear information or guidance, I don't say directions. And then once they get information and guidance, they tend to follow. So the Japanese government model, they didn't give any directions, but they gave very clear guidance. Very simple, three, which we have to follow the three. And one is stay away social distance, stay away from other person, 1.5 meters. And then following the information, everybody, every institution measured and put something, and we have to eat, stay away from other people. Second thing is wearing mask all the time. And then the Japanese people, all the Japanese people, 100% are wearing masks from morning until the end of the day. And third thing is silent eating, you know that? Silent eating. We cannot speak during eating. And everybody follows, even the younger generation. You know, when you're eating, you have to remove the mask. You cannot eat. Nobody was talking. So, yeah, that one is very new to many people, and we followed. And actually, this information we followed for 3 years. This is the point, main point of today's discussion. In your countries, the lockdown was enacted, but not for a long time. For how long? But in Japan, that very slight guideline was effective for 3 years, and younger generation, even me, followed for 3 years, and what happened to their psych and mental is tremendous.
Definitely, it's a very challenging situation. And in the US, what was the sensation that you feel when you were locked down in the US?
Firstly, I didn't feel much. Because I just started a startup, so everybody was all over the place anyway. So for me, I actually took advantage, and I was able to hire people all around the world who were now working from home. So for me, personally, it was an advantage. But I will say for most people, my wife, everyone else, my two kids in school, it was severely traumatic. Children are still because they were taken out of school. They feel like they missed some socialization, because when you're in school, you used to learn, that's where you learn to socialize with other people. And kind of in the long term, this lack of social development has been impacted on them, which we won't see that after years probably. And for working people who are sort of a little more adult now, working home, certainly was difficult because you had to do everything remotely, but I think there was a real sense of paranoia, just because there was so much information and misinformation, nobody really understood what it was going on.
Interesting. And another topic that I think that we should talk is about the hybrid work models. Because I think that before the pandemic, nobody think about go to work not every day, or think how can we do at home the work that was doing at the office. But now, at least in Spain, for example, they are in the younger generation, some people choose works because they are permitted to stay at home at least part of the time. If not, they say, no, I don't like to be in the office. And for example, it was very interesting. Was a survey made the last, I think, 3 or 4 weeks ago among CEOs of different companies,
and 75% of the CEOs said that they like that in 2 years the maximum the people will be 100% of the people will be on the office. And then there was a good bad reaction among the people in Twitter and other social networking medias, because they said, no, they don't understand nothing. We prefer to choose our quality of life instead of to be 5 days in the office. And then, I think it's a topic that we would like to think about.
It's funny because Michael Bloomberg in the US Bank said that even after COVID, the golf centers have never been as popular, and still to this day, instead of being in the office. So I think it's COVID gave people a taste of a different life, and especially I think it prompted entrepreneurship in some ways, because at least for sole proprietors starting their own companies, and a lot of people figured out, wait, I can maybe make money on my own at home for myself without having a boss, without working for a corporate company. And you know, it's a shift in the way we view working at companies. But my first thought when it happened and everybody went into Zoom exploded as a company, and the way we did meetings and so on. My first thought was, this is a taste of the metaverse coming that people are not thinking about, which I know from a technology perspective, I still believe very much it will come. Apple is launching it now in January, and I believe we will live our lives as much as we do on our phones. We live our half of our lives on our phones pretty much. We will live half of our lives in the metaverse at some point. So it was the COVID in many ways was a taste of what we will have eventually anyway, in my opinion.
Mm-hmm. I think she's also.
Yes, the battery is finished here, there's a microphone.
Yes,
switch hands. We have a solution for everything.
Thank you. As Hannah said, people started to think, oh, I can do it myself, this and that. It also comes back to what I said, we had the time to relax, sit back, and think, what else, instead of rolling in the hamster wheel. And I'm thinking, maybe we would come to this point due to technological advancements without COVID. Because now technology gives us all those abilities that we can do many things virtually. But COVID maybe made it faster, because in the training world, like the companies were not willing to get the trainer to do the session online before COVID. But the technology was allowing it. And instead of paying the flights and the costs to bring their people from all over, their dispersed teams, they would maybe come to the point of thinking that, oh, maybe virtual training for this session, for this subject, would be better now. Maybe they would do it, they would come to that point anyways, without the COVID. Just the COVID made it faster. And I also want to mention my experience. I was organizing trainings online in the beginning of COVID, and there were like 500 registrants. Like really people were popping up on Zoom, hundreds of people, like 200 plus. And the next year, people were so fed up with Zoom meetings, the same conference, same training, 1 year after, there were like barely 200 registrants, and then barely 100 popping up at one point, and they were not attending the full program back to back, but they were, some were leaving and some others were coming. So around 100 were there, but not the same people. So I think we need to make the sessions more vivid. And the new normal, I would like to say, is the fidget. together and consume everybody's time to learn something which they can reach within their finger points. So the some part of the training, some part of education should be digital, virtual, and for that the trainers, the educators, the instructors need to develop their virtual facilitation skills through other trainings that they were to get for themselves. And then some part of the training program needs to be physical, face-to-face, that people need to come prepared and they need to make this kind of discussions and share knowledge, share experiences from different parts of their world, their cultures. And as the globe is getting smaller and smaller, we need to use our FaceTime to discuss, to bring something out of the knowledge for making our world a better place, how we will apply it to the problems that we have, how we can create solutions for each of us, not just to learn something that some instructor can teach overnight.
Phil, I'm wondering about one topic. In the case of the musicians, during the pandemic, we saw several initiatives, very interesting, that people who was in different parts of the world, they was able to create some activities together, etc. But obviously the musicians, and especially when you are teaching music, probably you need people nearby, because they need to hear each one, especially if we are in an orchestra, something similar to that. But what do you think about, in this case, the hybrid work in the case of the music is not so easy, but what do you think about?
Now, are you talking about with students or with teachers? Or
with both.
With both. So I think what's happened is that the hybrid for the field of music, I mean, it's not the same for everyone. Mm-hmm. Some people have just got the same with the physical all the time.
Yeah.
But for the field of music education, I think we've adopted hybrid, but it's changed and changed and changed as we've gone on. So a lot of things that especially Denise was saying about both of you are true in our field as well. People loved Zoom in the first little while.
Yes.
People hated Zoom in the second little while. So those changes really occurred. People couldn't wait to get away from Zoom. And now we have a thing that's just talking about training teachers, they're doing a lot now of human training back to, and people do it because it feels like a bonded communal exercise. It feels like they're getting their emotions out in a way that you just can't do online, you know. So there's a lot about the humanness of those things that are great. During the week, I mean, you know, during the rest of the week, I'm online doing, you know, small groups, little mentoring things, you know. So we have this hybrid thing is working very well in music training. For kids, it worked very well, but kids really got tired. So very few of I work in all around the country dealing with different organizations. Very few of those organizations are staying with the online now. They put stuff online, but you know the thing is, as you said, it's the engagement online. You know, I'm there, we all are. We're in some online thing. You have a cup of tea. You know, I might have a biscuit and a sandwich while I'm there. You know, the engagement's not as intense, it's not as strong. With the kids that have the camera off a lot of the time, we don't even know what's in the room. So I think the blend is there, and we'll continue to work with the blend, continue to improve on it. And we haven't got around. Those multi-orchestra things are not live. You see what I mean? It's like recording. We haven't got around that fully, but we're constantly changing with the mix of physical. And what you were saying about that need to be in the room with people, to have that communal thing, to have that physicality of it, is massive for us.
Yeah. I just want to offer an observation, because I'm not as bullish as you are. I'm working on for me, that's true. But when I think about how corporations are set up, and they pay for labor, is how many dollars per hour, and that number changes where you are physically. And I think corporations, companies have to start thinking not about paying you for being there, but they have to start thinking about what is it producing and how does that value the company. If I go on vacation to Ghana and work in Ghana, HR promotion process is all of it is set up around something you can measure, like when did you clock in, when did you clock out, and we sort of culturally have to be in the center. Come back to that.
Yeah, I just wanted to add that with AI, predicting that also our working hours might go down, it's, I think also our time will be measured differently, and regardless in the future. But if you don't mind, I'd like to add on the education part and schooling. I think for the younger kids, it's extremely important to be back in the classroom for so many reasons. What I've seen in Norway has been very disappointing, in my opinion, is that on higher education, at the university level, they have totally retracted the opportunity even to do any classes online, even if you have health issues and you need to do surgery or have anything, and you can benefit from taking your classes online, let's say in those weeks you're in the hospital. You can't. And that's been shocking because we are a modern country in many ways, but to see how fast we snap that to the old school system without reacting, I find fascinating. And Norway is a traditional country in many ways, but one example for me right now, I'm studying psychology this fall, and I have my exams in some weeks, and we have mandatory classes, and if we don't attend, if we miss more than one, in my school, if we miss more than one mandatory class, we're not allowed to take our exams, which means you lose half a year of your life. And me being here at this conference today, on this trip, I am losing one of my mandatory classes. So it's very interesting when I told my school, well, I am ironically speaking on the panel on technology and education, but I asked my teacher, I don't want to miss the two hours of mandatory class, can I please zoom in on them, and I'll set it up myself. The teacher doesn't even have to do anything, you know. We're finished with COVID, we don't do digital anymore. So I am like, pretty much furious because we are, I believe we have an education system that is the way it's like from the 60s and it's going to get wiped out by technology. It's going to get wiped out by AI and metaverse and whatever is coming. I don't believe it from traditional. It's a different subject, I know, but I'd like to add it because I think it brings a perspective into where we're going. And I think if the universities are to survive, and also be for adults and be for people with health issues and people with children, because if you have a sick child and you need to stay at home, how are you supposed to take your exam if we have this system? Basically, so the system we have now in Norway, it pretty much is a suit for 19, 20-year-olds. But for everyone else, it makes education not available, which is a shame, and which is why I think technology needs to step in and make education available for more adults that wants to get more higher education.
Finland,
I'm going to pop on to another area from what you were saying, but before we do, I presume when you said education is in the 60s, I presume you meant the 1860s, is that, am I correct? Just checking.
It's what it feels like.
That's the panel we need to be on. We need to be on that panel. But the odd little thing we were talking about, you know, home, zooming in and all this kind of thing. We ran a project which was a combination. It started off as face-to-face and Zoom. So it was an international project. And one of our places was a place called Messina in Rio de Janeiro, which is, is a very large slum, very biggest in South America. It's a favela, as they call it. People build their own house and whatever. The kids would not engage for this reason. None of them wanted to turn the camera on in the place they lived because of the shame that they had about where they lived. It just occurred to me, we were talking about all these things, and I just thought, that's such an odd little thing about that.
Yeah.
Huh? Well, I probably didn't know
at that time that the mental barrier exists.
Yeah. But it was an interesting phenomenon.
And Benazir, what do you think about?
Yes, so in my point, for instance, after the, let's say, during the COVID, the government introduced an online education system where teachers were given the necessary tools to be on video, whatever course you are teaching, you have to pre-record it, and then you take it to the national TV, and then they will broadcast it entirely to the whole country. So students in every part of the country, in every village, because it's a national TV, every village has that network. So at a specific time, the parents will tell you, okay, it's 6 to 7. So by 6, the students are by their TV and they are watching. If it's science, for 1 hour, it is science. But after the TV, the lectures are over online, you are given assignments to do. So it really helped most of the students during that time, which I think it was something that the government initiated. Yeah.
Interesting. And Ekelori? Yes, no.
Yeah. In Japan, actually, Japanese society was very pessimistic about online and remote work. But it was Prime Minister Abe. He suddenly decided to do that. And actually, he didn't even talk to the Minister of Education. And he suddenly decided that, according to the media, it was like 1 hour before the press conference that he decided to make a decision. And then the Minister of Education was really against it. The reason he was against that is that if we suddenly change the education online, who take care of kids? That's what your question. Okay, and then, but the Prime Minister Abe strongly insisted that he suddenly started online. It was very sudden decision that all the institutions were very surprised. And then what happened is that the parents had to accept the reality, and the company had to accept the reality, and they started the remote work. And then as a result, what happened is that Japanese people also good at adjusting to new culture. And then they started to accept the reality, and what happened is that Japanese people started to feel satisfaction about the new life. And they started to emphasize on the family bond. They started to emphasize the importance of local community. And in Japan, the nuclear family has been increasing for the last 100 years or something, a long time, because of the westernization of the community. And we started to say that we lost something important thanks to the COVID. We realized the importance of family and communities, and we should make it important. And I think this is very important. So but as a chairperson of internationalization, what I think is that younger generations should be active in a global world. And when they graduate from university, they have to be active in a global society. But actually what happened is that they went back to the inward part. And they went back to the traditional comfort zone. This is what I've been worried about.
Very interesting. And I think that we have...
Yeah? Last five.
Oh, yes. I was just knowing that we have it in the 5 minutes. Now, the one question that is the future. Well, imagine that in our generation, never imagined that we was suffering a pandemic like that. But in case that in the future we will suffer another one, that's possible because the viruses are there, new viruses are coming and the threat are there. What do you think that we need to do according with the learning that we obtained from the pandemic? What do you think about that? Benazet, for example? No, now it's connected. Disconnected, yes. Okay.
I think that one is for governments of nations. They have to take new policies, learn from what happened, and then put in leaders that will put in actions, policies that will benefit the citizens of the country. And as I'm saying, what I'm just trying to say is that if in the past couple we had people death tolls in a nation, for instance, like 10,000, 20,000, and we've initiated policy that maybe in the near future, in the next epidemic, you shouldn't suffer same. At least some policies or some things you learn from that path to be able to guide you that the next event, these are what and what you have to do. You should be able to take steps to make sure that these things that happen will not happen again. If you say social distancing, understanding sure that these things work. If you say hospitals have to be made bigger, make sure people are trained well, if trained more students are given the necessary instruments and facilities to be able to have better patients, make sure you can do those things. Yes.
Well, I've already mentioned a little bit about what I think is the future, but I think there's some huge opportunities in the technology that's coming. And one of them that I want to bring up is that in higher education, the grades you need to get into certain subjects are really high. For example, in psychology, we had there's around only 20,000 applicants that get in. You need straight A's in all subjects to be able to even have a shot at getting in. And many have to go abroad because they can't get in Norway. They have to try and move to Poland to study. So I think, and I'm thinking, why? We have now 980 people that wanted to study psychology that didn't get in. So this is at least one area where I really believe in technology that we need to make education available to way more people. So I first and foremost kind of see it as an opportunity. It's going to be so massively disruptive that I think it's kind of sad because I come from a family that have been in the education system their entire lives. And I unfortunately think the traditional schools and university, that they will disappear and not exist in the same way, which is sad. But as we've learned with technology, we can't stop it and we just need to get on board and we need to make the very best out of it.
Mm-hmm. I believe the new normal, because the COVID happened, they lived it, and we will not come back. And technology is advancing every day, every moment. So we need to adapt. And I think the best skill for anyone to develop in themselves is adaptability, flexibility, and being open to new changes and new developments. The main skill for younger people is to be able to learn, unlearn, and relearn. We need to be able to unlearn also to empty up, and then have more space for new things to come in. And the digital, I strongly believe that the physical and digital will be together. Like the university that I'm doing my industrial and organizational psychology, a PhD right now, is in US, an online university founded 30 years ago. As an online university, at the beginning, for the federal government employees to be able to enhance their education, their postgraduate education. So now, of course, they have an amazing system that perfectly works. I might say it's even better than face-to-face universities. but it also has the element of residencies that you can meet and face-to-face discuss with the professors. Also, it has complementary programs like the writing center, the statistical center, that you can attend their organization, their events. So we should be able to build more within the systems thinking, more holistic thinking. We should build programs that doesn't just have, okay, one training, one event, and you're done for this certification. So it needs to have a prep part with online learning, with the knowledge part, and then the face-to-face core part that we discussed. Maybe it has a third part, which you have an assignment that you need to do by yourself, and then discuss it with peers online, and then, you know, get as the testing afterwards. So it needs to be different steps coming together, adding on to each other, and then you can adapt every part of, little parts of it, according to the developments or the need of the day at that time.
Okay, thank you. Very fast, a very quick question for Akinori, and then feel finished.
I'm ready. I'm not ready for that answer. Flexibility is important. Flexibility is important. We should try our best all the time. And then the global partnership, like process, is always important.
Thank you. It's a good point.
Sure. Yeah, much to agree with. I mean, great stuff there. I think one thing that we can draw again on in the future, because you talk about future pandemics, is the heroism that we saw from frontline workers and that sense of community that became a global sense of community. I think that is there. The only other thing I'd say is that we didn't get that from our leaders, so we have a distrust of leaders. So I would like to see leadership being redefined, and that in education, children to understand that they have a role as leaders. That I think would make a great difference. Thank you.
Thank you very much, all of you. It was an honor and a pleasure to be here with all of you. It was a very interesting and very nice discussion. And for me, the time ran. When I realized that it was almost finishing. But it's because it was so interesting that it was a real pleasure. Probably, I must say that in all the opportunities that I had to chair a session, this was probably the best one that I ever chaired. Thanks to all of you.
Thank you, sir.
Thank you very much. See you in the near future, I hope so.
Yeah.
Yes. And can you take a picture of all of us?
I can take your pictures.
Yes, please.
One seated, okay.
Yes, please.